Movement has arrived. A movement that defines our future. Its pure progressive shapes fascinate us. Its lightning performance energizes us. Its intelligent applications and services help us relax. And its unparalleled use of sustainable technology reflects our desire to live responsibly. It combines what we know with what we dream of. The possible with the impossible. It combines what is good for us with what is good for our planet. This is a new world of revolutionary mobility. This is BMW i. Born electric.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. For us, today is a very special moment. We're setting a milestone in the history of the BMW Group. As chairman of the board and as an engineer, I'm very proud of this project, behind which you will find true pioneering spirit and great innovative strength. Mobility is and will remain a basic requirement of all human beings, but what's changing fundamentally is how people in different regions of the world over the next decades will want to move around, how they are able to do so, and what they will be allowed in this regard. We're considering the mobility of the future. Others do quite the same, but the question is, how far-sighted you go about this process? We want to give answers to the challenges of our time. And for this, we have to look beyond the present. With our Project I, we've taken an exceptional approach, and today we would like to present the first results to you. This is the world premiere of the new BMW i family. Here's the BMW i3 concept and the BMW i8 concept. Ladies and gentlemen, why have we created BMW i? Well, the brand BMW is amongst the most popular and best-known brands in the world. Today, it's a symbol of dynamism and special efficiency. And with e-mobility, we'll add another type of individual mobility, which offers opportunities in times of climate change, but especially for conurbations. Instead of fossil fuels, we're using electricity, and that means that during the drive, no harmful pollutants are emitted. If the energy is from renewable sources, then pure e-vehicles are completely carbon neutral while driving. In the first phase of e-mobility, there were many ideas and quick solutions, but those all entailed significant compromises. And we wanted to offer our customers a convincing premium offer, tailor-made for this new type of drive. And what's even more, not just the vehicles themselves were to be sustainable, but also their production. That's our goal, that's our aim. And for the BMW i vehicles, for the first time ever, in the early phases of the conception, we set binding sustainability goals for all steps of the value chain. And it was well worth it. For once, the BMW i3 concept is completely emission-free on the road, as long as the energy comes to, or the electricity comes from renewable sources. But on the other hand, its CO2 footprint was taken into account from raw materials through to recycling, and that is shown by the comparison to a highly efficient combustion engine vehicle from the same segment. Across its whole life cycle, the CO2 footprint of the BMW i3 is improved by at least one-third, and that is with the standard power generation mix or electricity mix that we currently have in Europe. And if we look at renewable energies, then we have a significantly improved CO2 emission reduction to more than 50%, which is unique across the automotive industry. Both cars, by the way, are being built here in Germany in the BMW plant in Leipzig. And in the production of the BMW i3 and i8, we're setting new standards in with regards to sustainability. We're reducing the energy intake per car by 50%, and we're reducing the water consumption by 70%. What we want to do is that we want to gain all the energy that's needed for assembly completely from renewable energy sources. And currently, we're checking the opportunity to set up our own wind power station on the area of the BMW plant in Leipzig. So you can see that BMW i is setting new standards across the whole value chain. But above all, born electric really fits the dynamism of the brand BMW. In the BMW i3, the whole torque is available from the start on. You can accelerate up to top speed immediately. And for us, it's always been clear that we're developing our electric engines ourselves, because the drive is and will remain the heart of our automobiles. And for all this, BMW i is a clear symbol. With BMW i, we're looking beyond our vehicles and we're offering an additional portfolio of mobility services. Innovative connectivity functions link the BMW i3 and the i8 to the lives of the drivers. In addition, we have services that can be used independently of the car. And what's even more, with BMW i, we are appealing to new customers. And we want to reach those customers in their specific environments. That's why we're opening up new distribution channels. And here we rely on selected dealers, a mobile sales force, and the internet, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, BMW i is much more than an innovative e-vehicle for megacities and an extremely economical hybrid sports car. It's about a new understanding of mobility. As the BMW Group, we share one vision. We want to become the leading provider of premium products and premium services for individual mobility. BMW i is an important step into this direction. My colleague, Klaus Dräger, will explain details of the cars to you now. Thank you very much for your attention. Ladies and gentlemen, the majority of the e-cars that are currently on the market are so-called conversion cars. So these are series cars in which the combustion engine was simply replaced by an electric drive. But conversions are always a compromise. We want to offer alternative drives without any compromises. And that's why we developed these cars from scratch as pure electric cars or as plug-in hybrids. The BMW i3 concept and the BMW i8 concept encompass the characteristics of BMW i. They are tailor-made for alternative drives. They rely on extreme lightweight constructions, and they offer superior driving dynamisms with ranges that are suitable for everyday driving. They set standards with regards to a sustainable value chain. The BMW i3 concept is being driven electrically. With its range of 150 kilometers, it is perfectly suited for driving in urban environments. Thanks to its dimensions, it's suitable for everyday work. It has four seats, wide opening, opposing doors, and a trunk capacity of approximately 200 liters. But two points I would like to underline. For one, the innovative vehicle architecture, and on the other hand, the electric drive. The BMW i3 concept is based on a life drive architecture, as we call it, and that turns it light, agile, safe, and spacious. The body is separated into two horizontal modules, the drive module, which contains the drivetrain. It's made of aluminum and it offers enormous advantages. For once, we set a low center of gravity and the perfect axle weight distribution for the BMW i3 concept, which creates high agility and the BMW typical driving feel. And on the other hand, through the central integration of the battery, we can offer a spacious and clearly designed interior, which means that we offer roominess on a very small floor space. On top of the drive module, we have the life module with a passenger compartment made of carbon fiber reinforced plastics, or CFRP for short. It's the first large series car, ladies and gentlemen, worldwide, whose body is made in large parts of CFRP. That is a revolution. With the life drive architecture, we reduce the weight compared to a conversion car by approximately 250 to 350 kilograms. And that means more driving dynamism, higher ranges per kilowatt hours of electricity. The e-engine and the power electronics have been completely developed by BMW. The engine offers 125 kilowatts and a torque of 250 newton meters. From 0 to 60 kilometers per hour, the BMW i3 concept accelerates in less than 4 seconds, and we reached 100 kilometers per hour in less than 8 seconds. At the socket, the batteries are fully loaded after 6 hours, and with a fast charging device, after only 1 hour, we reach 80% battery load. Sustainability plays a large role when it comes to BMW i. And the interior also fulfills this demand. We've reduced renewable and naturally treated raw materials. Parts of the instrument panel, of the door panels, and the floor section consist of natural fibers. 25% of the plastic used in the interior are from recycled material or renewable raw materials. Let me now talk about the BMW i8 concept, ladies and gentlemen. In this plug-in hybrid, the combination of an electric engine and the combustion engine creates extremely sporty and dynamic driving at extremely low consumption levels. The live drive architecture in this case is targeted for the characteristic of a sports car. Both the engines of the BMW i8 concept are integrated in the front and rear axle modules. And all that is linked through the live module, which consists of ultra-light and extremely torsion-resistant CFRP. Therefore, also this car has a low center of gravity, which is typical for a sports car. Together with the positioning of the engines right on top of the axles, that leads to a perfect axle weight distribution of 50% on the front axle and 50% on the rear axle. This plug-in hybrid combines the electric engine of the BMW i3 concept on the front axle with the high-performance three-cylinder petrol engine with an output of 164 kilowatts on the rear axle. So that offers three different drive modes. Purely electric, for example, while driving in a city. Second mode, a combination of e-engine and combustion engine for quick acceleration and sporty driving. And then the third mode, only with the combustion engine, for example, on the Autobahn. And ladies and gentlemen, these are the values. It accelerates from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in less than 5 seconds. And it consumes less than 3 liters of fuel for that. Ladies and gentlemen, no other car with a pure combustion engine on this performance level reaches those figures. And the highlight of the plug-in concept is the electric energy is taken from the socket, and therefore, ideally, from eco-electricity. Fully loaded, the BMW i concept has a range of up to 35 kilometers in purely electric mode, which is sufficient for most trips within a city. The BMW i concept offers space for up to 4 people and is therefore really suitable for everyday usage. If you look at the design, the dynamic proportions truly visualize it and underline its sporty performance. And the sporty character of the BMW i8 concept is of course also reflected on the interior. The cockpit is extremely oriented towards the driver. So with the BMW i8 concept, we have the sports car of a new generation, pure, emotional, and sustainable. Of course, I would like to tell you much more about these cars. But today in the afternoon you will have workshops in which we can go much more into depth and you will receive more in-depth information, and that's why I would like to thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Hey, cool video, huh? Now's a good time to search the AutoChannel.com's buyer's guides to quickly and easily find the most in-depth news, specs, prices, rebates, crash ratings, and recalls for every vehicle sold in North America. TheAutoChannel.com, there's nothing else like it.
My name is Richard Leopold, Head of Product Marketing at Bentley Motors. I'm here today to talk to you about the Continental Flying Spur 09 model year. Now, the Flying Spur itself started out in history back in 1957 when H.J. Mulliner wanted to create a car for fast continental touring with additional luggage capability built off the two-door. Back then, the first year of sales achieved 273 units, 80% of which was here in the UK. 2005 saw the return of the Flying Spur to the marketplace. A very different story. The first full year achieved almost 4,500 units, and interestingly, 80% of its sales was outside of the UK. Clearly, the Flying Spur hit a sweet spot in the marketplace, leveraging the style and the performance from the GT, and also combined that with the luxury and the comfort expected of a four-door saloon. The Continental Flying Spur soon established itself as one of the most exclusive luxury four-door saloons on offer, and it achieved number one selling position in terms of the 12-cylinder market in most major countries around the world. Not only externally has it been a success, but internally at Bentley, it now accounts for over a third of the sales over the past 3 years and is a critical component in the business moving forward. So, the 2009 model year is all about raising the bar. Competitors have moved on. There are more entries now in the sector with new and improved offers. So it's time for Bentley to take a step forward in the history of the Flying Spur. 2009 sees the introduction of two distinctive models in the Flying Spur range, the Continental Flying Spur and the Continental Flying Spur Speed. Now, the Continental Flying Spur offers best-in-class refinement for the first time, new levels of comfort and an extensive range of choice to the customer. In fact, many options in terms of colour, trim and finish are things that have been available only in the R&R series until today. The Continental Flying Spur Speed delivers a more dynamic driving experience, agile handling and engagement with the driver. This will certainly be popular with those who are looking to combine the thrill of driving with the practicalities associated with a four-door saloon. So with the 2009 Continental Flying Spur range, it really is time to write history once again.
I just want to spend a few moments taking you through the newly enhanced levels of design and comfort on the Continental Flying Spur and the introduction of the Continental Flying Spur Speed at 09 model year. I'll also spend time taking you through the extensive range of new optional features which provide greater levels of customer choice and the opportunity for personalisation. At 09 model year, the Continental Flying Spur benefits from a more upright front grille and revised lower air intakes. You may have noticed that this car has been specified with the cost option of bright chrome lower grilles and a new cost option feature, adaptive cruise control. The front of the car also benefits from chrome headlight bezels, which increases the focal bright wear on the front of the car, enhancing the fresh new look. The refined styling continues to the back of the car, where we have a revised rear bumper, which encompasses a cutaway black valance and wraparound bright wear, which creates a lower, sleeker look. The car also benefits from chrome bezels around the tail lamps, which enhances the fresh new rear look. At 09 model year, the refinement enhancements are not just cosmetic. This car has been specified with the new 19-inch comfort tyre. So let's now talk about the Continental Flying Spur Speed. This car boasts a W12 600 brake horsepower, 610 PS engine with all-round lowered suspension, providing a more powerful and engaging drive. The Continental Flying Spur Speed takes on the design enhancements of the Continental Flying Spur at 09 model year, but with some slight feature differentiation. The Speed, as standard, takes on a dark tint upper and lower grille. Exclusive to Speed, we have a new 20-inch multi-spoke wheel. In this case, this car is specified with the cost option dark tint. The distinguishing feature at the rear of the car is the new rifle tailpipes, completing the new sporting look. The sporting nature of this car continues on the inside. As standard on a Continental Flying Spur Speed, we have diamond quilting with indented hide, drilled aluminium foot pedals, and a sports gear lever. Exclusive to Speed, we have the new three-spoke steering wheel with brush switch surround. This car has also been specified with a cost option of dark tint aluminium fascia, which is also available in bright. Another identifying feature of the Continental Flying Spur Speed is the unique Speed tread plates fitted to all four doors. 2009 model year sees the introduction of two very distinctive models with two very different characters, offering our customers more choice, more refinement, and more power.
In 2005, I was very kindly invited by Bentley to come and have a test drive in the then new Continental Flying Spur.
Now, they could have so easily produced something that was, let's say, only 4 litres. Somebody said, well, if only it had another 100 horsepower. You're never going to say about this car, if only it had another 100 horsepower, if only it had a bit more room in it, if only it had better brakes, if only it had more acceleration. I mean, it's 0 to 60 in 5 seconds. It does virtually 200 miles an hour, 185 without any problem anywhere you want to go.
Now, here we are in 2008, and Bentley very kindly invited me back to drive the 2009 model year Continental Flying Spur, and of course, the new Continental Flying Spur Speed.
Now, this is what I've been waiting for. Hear that familiar burble? I just love that sound. Anyway, let's go and see what we can do. Now, there's a familiar sound there. But you notice the way it stayed in that gear all the way through there? I mean, that's amazing. It hasn't even gone up yet. It goes up at 100 miles an hour. What a beautiful... It's just so smooth, isn't it? It's just effortless. And just no sound. I mean, you could definitely hear the engine as it went. You can't help. You've got a W12 revving at, you know, 5,500 revs. You're going to hear it. You can't get away from that. But the wind noise is non-existent. And once I'm up to speed and cruising, it's just negligible. When I accelerate and start to work through the corners, the ride is very, very smooth indeed. It absorbs the bumps. And of course, the engineers at the factory, what they've done, they've actually softened up the shocks, softened up the springs, and softened up the anti-roll bars, yet somehow maintained this fabulous platform where the car actually is very flat going around the corners without any noticeable roll. It is beautiful the way it actually absorbs it all. With all the work that's gone on, it sort of gives a more refined, relaxed atmosphere for both me in the front and I assume for the passenger in the rear. I'll find out when I do ultimately get in the back seat. So here I am in the 2009 model year car, and it really is delightful. I mean, absolutely beautiful. The seating is very, very comfortable. That's the first bit one has to really mention. It's one of the three options that we have, but we have the two-seat option with the bench seat in the middle, and the two outer seats actually are totally adjustable. And you can tune them into the passenger's sort of personal likes and dislikes. But it's really, really lovely, very, very comfortable to sit back here. And of course, as we talked to about earlier, we have, of course, all this new soundproofing. And I can't wait, actually, to put the name entertainment system on and to listen to some of the music if I get time and I stop talking. For somebody that likes the ultimate in speed, I have to say that this car just about foots the bill. The most amazing thing is that it's actually a flying spur speed. And it really is quite a remarkable car. I've enjoyed every second I've been driving it. And it's astonishing what's happened in the last 3 years since we ran the original Flying Spur at Bruntingthorpe. I mean, it's just phenomenal the way this car handles. And when you actually get down to what it offers, it's very, very special. And it's a car that 4 years ago was a wonderful handling, wonderfully powerful car. And I said it couldn't make it go any faster. And then suddenly I get into this car, which I have to say, has probably been developed for a very limited number of special people that want something a little bit more powerful than anything else. And I mean, just look at the inside of this car. It's absolutely phenomenal. I mean, it strikes you, it hits you in the face. It says, I'm ready to be driven. Take me out and drive me. And that's the impression I've had throughout the moments that I've driven this. The acceleration, I mean, 0-60 in 4.6 seconds. It's absolutely phenomenal what it does. You have ceramic brakes as an option. 10 millimeters lower all round. Slightly stiffer suspension everywhere. We know that the exhaust system is slightly better, slightly more efficient. I mean, what a wonderful car. Well, what a wonderful day I've had. I've driven two new cars, both of them flying spurs. And we all have the choice of which one we want to buy. With one, you have the ultimate in refinement and in comfort. And with the other, you have speed, you have performance, and that extra bit of power. Who's the lucky boy?
So looking at the Continental Flying Spur 09 model year chassis changes, then we've concentrated on softening off the suspension, the springs, the dampers, and also paying particular attention to the suspension bushes in order to improve the ride comfort for the occupants. And that's particularly true for the rear seat occupants. So to complement those chassis changes, we developed a new tyre for this model. This is the new 19-inch tyre, and what we've done is to take the learning from the GT Speed 20-inch tyre, and what we've done is to adopt the same construction here. And what we found in the GT Speed development is that this construction offers improvements in both handling and steering, but also in ride comfort. So we've got a win-win situation with this new tyre.
With all the work that's gone on, it sort of gives a more refined, relaxed atmosphere for both me in the front and I assume for the passenger in the rear. I'll find out when I do ultimately get in the back seat. But the feeling that I've got is from the driving aspect, because that's what I'm doing, and it's just this effortless form of driving, which the car absorbs the bumps, it goes around the corner very smoothly, it does everything effortlessly, and I think that is probably what I'm trying to say. The actual feedback through the steering, it's a very positive feedback, which this car's always had, tremendous feedback, but it's lost a lot of its of the sort of the impact that came back through the steering. It's now a very much finer, more delicate feedback that I'm getting through the car, yet really very positive. So when I actually go to do something, it's there. I mean, immediately, it's there. And it's just there. And that's what you need. It's no good having a car that has all these attributes, and then when you actually go to drive it, it doesn't respond. This car has all these beautiful attributes, and then when I go to make a sudden move to avoid, you know, a rock in the road, the car just moves and it does it.
So let's go and have a look at the Continental Flying Spur speed. For this car, we've introduced a number of changes to improve the dynamic performance of the vehicle. We've solid mounted the front subframe. That gives an excellent steering feel and a linear response to the chassis. We've changed the bushes on the rear axle for the same reason. We've also lowered the ride height of the vehicle to give a better appearance, a more sporty appearance. And we've applied the GT Speed wheel and tyre combination. So this is the 20-inch wheel, which gives us an excellent sporty response and character to the vehicle.
Well, as you can imagine, being a racing driver, the one thing that I always love is the ultimate in power and the ultimate in speed. And I've had just that driving this car. It's quite amazing to realize that this actually is a flying spur speed. The handling of the car really is superb, and I've really enjoyed driving it today. But I think it's been down to the fact the engineers of the factory have stiffened the whole car up. They made it tauter. They made it a little bit more agile than it was. And this is due to the fact they created a solid-mounted subframe and, in fact, improved the rear suspension links, which, of course, overall makes the car a little bit more stiffer, a little bit more stable. They've created stiffer springs all around, slightly heavier damping. And this has made the car the most superb car to drive. You better get out there and have a go. I've enjoyed it very much.
So in summary, we've got two great driver's cars, but the Continental Flying Spur Speed will appeal more to the guy for whom driving is the important thing, a guy that wants a responsive chassis. Whereas the Continental Flying Spur will appeal more to the guy for whom comfort and refinement are the important factors.
Our Continental Flying Spur customers were telling us that they use the cars in different ways. We had owner-drivers who appreciated the sporting prowess and character of the car, and we had chauffeur customers all around the world who spent a great deal of time in the back of the car and expected comfort, quietness and opulence. 09 model year has provided us with an opportunity to take the customer feedback and identify technologies which we can deploy in the car to give the customers more choice. As chauffeured customers who spend a lot of time in the back of the car, they wanted a quieter car but with some of the Bentley character.
There is a new exhaust system being designed for this car, but in fact which does make it somewhat quieter, but there's still that burble and the bubble of the car as you really hit it. Listen to that as it goes. Just listen to that going away.
Our owner driver customers were telling us that they loved the exhaust character and didn't really want to trade off that much. In fact, some were asking for even more exhaust noise. Finally, the other area of focus in terms of general cabin acoustics was the deployment of modern tri-laminate technologies in the wheel arch stations, along the full length of the underside of the car and in the front wheel arch, and acoustic trim pack enhancements in the trunk and in the rear seat areas to provide increased levels of isolation from both exhaust noise and road noise.
Modern traffic conditions mean that actually using a conventional cruise control system is actually becoming less and less possible due to the number of times that a vehicle will cut in, or changes in speed mean that you ultimately have to cancel and then reset the system. For 2009 model year, for the Continental Flying Spur and the Flying Spur Speed, we've developed an all-new adaptive cruise control system. Adaptive cruise control is an extension of conventional cruise control and is classified as a comfort system and therefore has no safety function. The ACC uses a radar mounted at the front of the car in the lower grille to monitor the traffic conditions up ahead. The benefit of ACC is that you can set a target set speed and your desired time gap to the vehicle in front, and then the vehicle will autonomously maintain that distance up to your set speed.
Well, now we've got a chance to actually give a demonstration to me as well as to you of adaptive cruise control. This is a system that we've incorporated at Bentley now as an option on the 09 Flying Spur. And it is a really fantastic system for me. It's something that I've never experienced before. And we have, in this case, the car is set at 70 miles an hour, and that is what it'll run at. I can adjust it to how close I want to be to the car in front. And the car will therefore run at that speed at 70 miles an hour in this particular case. And if somebody pulls in front of me, it would immediately slow me down or put the brakes on in a difficult situation.
The ACC system has a driver selected set speed between 20 miles per hour and 130 miles per hour, or 30 kilometers per hour and 210 kilometers per hour. The maximum positive acceleration is about 20% of maximum acceleration, and the deceleration limit is about 30% of full braking.
Now this is going to take me right down to a very, very slow speed at the junction. And in fact, we have a thing called follow to stop with this particular system that is actually particularly special to Bentley, and it will allow us to actually go right down to 0 miles an hour. Look at that, right the way down to stop. Look at that, isn't that fantastic? And it's actually stopped. I haven't got my foot on the brakes.
What this means to the customer is that the driving experience is much smoother and more comfortable for the driver and passengers alike.
Looking for a new car or truck? TheAutoChannel.com has the most complete and up-to-date pricing, vehicle specifications, and reviews.
Direct from Switzerland, the Auto Channel presents exclusive press pass coverage of the Geneva International Motor Show. Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great coverage of all major motor events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive resource.